Hi, my name is Ed Douglas, and it's my great pleasure to welcome to the Banff Centre Peter Habeler. Peter, of course, is most famous for being one of the first two men to climb Everest without oxygen. But as we're going to find out, there is a great deal more to him than that. Peter, you are from the Tyrol.
Right, yes. Well,
you're from the Zillertal. Can you tell me what it's like growing up somewhere like that? Because that, the Zillertal is a place with a, you know, a great culture and a great tradition from the mountains.
Yes, it is. And that was the reason why I started mountaineering. Of course, it's not only mountaineering. We have, it's a tourist center, like all these places nearby the mountains. But this big Zillertal range, which is sort of separating Italy, I mean, Südtirol from Austria, has fantastic mountains and not easy ones, you know. Mm. Of course, the mountains are not that high. It's 3,500 meters, our highest one. But with many steep faces, so you could say almost like the Bergell, if you know that mm-hmm. place.
Yeah.
And so I grew up there and off I went, you know.
It was a natural thing to do growing up as a climber, to grow up as a climber.
Yes, yes. And I was about 8 years when I lost my father. He was 50 years. He died when he was 50. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, my mother let me go, you know, which was very important. Mm. She was not afraid that I would get harmed or would have an accident. So, and then as a little boy, I was going up to these mountain huts and people came and I was a young guide, you know, being 8, 9, 10 years old. Yeah. I would guide them, of course, on easy things, you know, just easy walks, easy hikes.
Right. So as a child, you were a guide?
I sort think, of. Yes, I'm still a childish guide as well, you know. But anyway, there was a good time. And that brought me deeper into this fantastic world of alpinism and climbing.
You say your father died when you were still quite young. Was he a climber too, or...?
Not at all. No, he was a hunter. He was a man who would hunt.
Right.
But he was not a climber. And in my former family, nobody was a climber.
It was a natural thing for you to do as a young boy, to get out into the mountains.
Yes. There was nothing else to do.
Sure.
Just climbing, you know, hiking, climbing.
Yeah. But there is also climbers there in the Zillertal. Were they early heroes for you, early people who inspired
well,
you?
All the mountain guides, we were living in a small house, and there was one mountain guy who sometimes had clients, and he would walk by, you know, and with the rope and with the rucksack and with the ice axe, mm-hmm. because nowadays it's different. But in the old days, they would have the rope around their neck, I was impressed. And then I was also lucky to get these guys to teach me, because they realized I liked to hike, I liked to climb, you know, and they taught me. Mm. And I think it's very important, being a young man and a young child, whatever, to have good teachers. I think this is the most important thing, anyway, to me, because they tell you whatever is necessary. They tell you which is not necessary in climbing, you know. And I believe they had a great deal to do with that I'm still around, I'm still alive, I can still do whatever I want to do, mm-hmm. which is climbing, right? I'm very thankful for them.
Right. I mean, they gave you clearly a very solid grounding in understanding the mountains.
Exactly.
But it's a different thing to be, say, a good mountain guide, a very solid, reliable, safe climber, to being somebody who is ambitious as a climber.
Sure, but I was never a local hero. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to be a local hero. Because we know all these local heroes, and you know, they climb whatever is nearby their house or nearby their home. But I used the Zillertal Mountains for going higher. Mm. And there again, I was lucky. Of course, the mountain guides left. I left the mountain guides again. And I was lucky again to meet other people. I was lucky to meet some really strong extreme climbers who were not guides, you see. But Messner came along.
Can you remember where you first
met him? Yes, we met in the Dolomites at a very very small hut near Cortina d'Ampezzo.
Yeah,
we were on a winter climb. I was with Horst Fankhauser, who is a very close friend of mine, also a guide. Mm. And there was Reinhold. I don't even know what he was doing, but he joined our team, and we did this fantastic Tofana pillar.
Yeah,
in winter time, which was hard, you know. And that was the start of something which was rather unique. Mm-hmm. We were very happy to so to speak, have each other and to do good things.
Because you were heading in similar directions. You felt that you were.
Same thing. Yeah. And with Reinhold, you could do everything. You know, he was very strong on ice. He was very strong, very good on rock. Mm-hmm. Of course, he also had wild ideas, which is important because you have to. Being a mountaineer who wants to go higher, you have to, how do you call it, frech, cheeky, huh, or whatever. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you have to think, just give it a try, you know, because if you're too scared, then you never get anywhere.
Right.
And that's that was easy with Reinhold to say, well, let's do the Matterhorn North Face, let's do the Eiger North Face in a different style, which was important to us.
I mean, when you met him for the first time on Tofana, how did he strike you? Do you remember how you felt about him? I mean, did he appear? He often appears to people very arrogant. Did he come across like that as a young man, or was he different then?
No. Important to me, no. He was very, just like, I mean, we were young, you know, and I didn't notice any arrogance or whatever. Mm-hmm. I never did. Mm-hmm. And I never did when I was with him, right?
Yeah.
Of course, he's a bit different than I am. Right, but maybe that's the main reason why we got together so well. He was not a mountain guide.
No.
He was for a short while. He was running a mountain school, but not for a long time. You know, this was at the Seller Pass. But anyway, I think Reinhold is much more an adventurous type of person, which was shown later on when he was in the Arctic, when he went through the Taklamakan, when he walked through the desert of Gobi. And this was not so this is not so interesting for me. I'm only, you know.
You were a climber.
I was a climber, and I still am a climber.
I'm a climber, yeah. But the guiding thing is a very interesting thing, because guiding has been a very important part of your life.
I think it's fantastic. Guiding is nice because you have the chance of meeting people who you can show whatever you like, you see? Mm-hmm. And if you do this cleverly, I mean, you bring these people come to you, they want to climb this mountain, you know? They want to climb the Grosse Glocke, they want to climb Mont Blanc. So they want to go to the summit. And then you are responsible for them. You take them up, maybe they don't have the time to train so hard, but you have to, I think it's psychologically quite interesting to get these people up to high peaks, because you see, then you find out how much they appreciate it.
Yeah.
And as they appreciate,
yeah,
it's a pleasure for me as well.
But all I'm saying, I think, is that you're a people person. You like being around people.
I think the most interesting thing in life are other people. Mm. You know, people, they're different. Mm-hmm. And I was always eager, I think, I was always eager to learn, to get something more. And being a guide, you have a chance to meet people on an incredible, nice level.
Yeah.
I mean, I was climbing with professors, you know, big hotshots, transplanting hearts and livers and all that stuff. Mm. So you learn from them. I was also doing a lot of climbing with politicians, you know. Mm-hmm. I was for many years the so-called head guide for our prime minister. Mm-hmm. But what I like, they are in the mountain. They are just—they're just as small or as big as anybody else.
Sure, sure.
And this I enjoy very much.
Sure. In terms of your ambitions, you said that you know there was this understanding between you and Messner about the direction that you were going in as climbers, and clearly he was more focused in that. You know, he didn't have the guiding, he didn't have perhaps some of the aspects in his life that you had.
Maybe.
But your goals were similar. What was it in the past that inspired your future, is what I mean.
I was a hungry young man. Mm-hmm. I was hungry, right? You do something which is hard, and then you want to do something which is even harder. Mm-hmm. And of course, you have these faces where the famous faces. I think I pointed out already the Eiger face,
of course,
for example, right?
Yeah.
So we knew that this, just a little example, we knew it had not been climbed. I had been tried to do in one day, but it was not possible, right? So and we knew we are fast, we are strong, we fitted very, very nicely. Mm-hmm. We did fit, because I had the feeling when Messner was with me on a face, he cannot fall. He cannot come off the face. And he probably had the same feeling, if Peter is leading, he cannot fall off. And that gives you immense strength. Mm-hmm. Because if somebody is leading, if he's leading, I can relax, I rest.
Right.
And then we change lead again, and he can rest, relax. And there was never fear that he would fall off.
Right.
Whoever you climb with who is weak, you become weak yourself.
Right.
Because you see him, you know, standing on a little foothold and everything is shaking.
Yeah.
And then you think, ooh, whoa.
Yeah.
So we somehow made each other better. We raised each other, which I think is, we uplifted each other, which I think is very important.
Sure, I can see how important that is. But the hallmark of your climbing was speed. You were so fast.
Yeah, but not only that. It was not only speed. We didn't want to do it faster. I mean, there's a little element also involved with ego, mm-hmm. naturally, you know. Mm-hmm. You want to be a little bit faster than somebody else. But I think the main thing in the mountains is you have also problems. You can have bad weather, you know. And I never did like bivouac. I was never a good bivouac, right?
Yeah.
So I shouldn't say I hate it, because sometimes you had to do it. But normally I would like to start the climb and be in bed again.
At the end of the day.
At the end of the day, or maybe at the start of the night, okay?
Yeah.
And this was the reason why we really trained, and which I said already again, fitting nicely together, we were able to move at the same time. Mm-hmm. We would climb on the Eiger, for example. We climbed the ice fields. We climbed simultaneously, would you call it? We climbed at the same time.
Yep.
You know, I was leading and he would follow,
So
sometimes we put in an ice crew. And that helped, you know, it made us even more speedier. And of course, on big mountains, on peaks, of course I go ahead now, on peaks like the 8,000ers and the 6,000ers and the 7,000ers, you should be fast. I mean, you don't have to run up, right?
No.
But you should be fast. And there are many things which you can train. We had a very light bag. We had only one rope instead of two ropes. We had for the food nuts and raisins in our pockets. Mm-hmm. You know,
mm-hmm. Erhard Loraton called it Leisure Express.
Right.
You know, this idea of you're right. It's not just about speed. It's about competency.
I think so.
And about you know, just being a neat, fast team, doing it well is what I mean. But for Messner, I think looking into history, say Hermann Bull was an ideal for that kind of approach, you know?
Yes, he was a very good rock climber.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how good he was in ice, you know, but excuse me, he was very good on rock. And I should add this, you know, there's always, if you go and do a climb, there's a certain nervousness in you. Okay? And I was more or less sometimes a nervous partner. I wanted to get it done over with, so to speak. Also, I enjoyed it. Every minute you enjoy, you like it.
Yeah.
Even if the weather is bad, okay, you hang on but you try to get it over and done with.
Mm-hmm.
And you try to, after the summit, you try to come down again quickly. And Bull was the same kind of person. And Bull, of course, was doing all these things, if you talk of Nanga Parbat and Broad Peak, etc., and so on. And in our days, of course, now I think there are very few heroes around, but in our days, Bull was was a big man.
Because nationalism has a big part to play, or has had in the past a big part to play in mountaineering, not always in a very comfortable way, if you like. You think about some of the expeditions in the 30s.
Yes.
Were you conscious of that? Because, I mean, Reinhold was very conscious of that, wasn't he?
Well,
about
I don't
some
know
of these
whether
issues.
He was really conscious, so conscious, or whether he just tells us that he was conscious.
Okay.
Of course, I was born in 42, right?
Right.
And I was much more concentrating, and I was much more thinking about the things we did and all these other things. I was living in the countryside, you know.
Right.
Of course, we didn't have money, but we never suffered because we had milk, we had bread, and we had cheese to eat, okay?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
However, we should not forget that the Nanga Parbat, being a German mountain, Kanchenjunga being a British mountain, Everest being a British mountain, K2 being almost an American mountain in a certain way.
Yeah.
So Nanga Parbat would tell me quite a bit more because I read more about Nanga Parbat.
Right. And, right. In terms of the things that you were doing in the 60s with Messner, you did these alpine faces very, very quickly, the Matterhorn in 4 hours, the Eigerwand in 9 hours? Or?
Yeah, a little bit more than 9 hours.
Yeah.
We teamed up for good things, but I had also other climbing
partners.
Who else
were you climbing with at the time?
At that time, I was climbing with a guy who later on went to America, a mathematic genius.
Right.
He was studying mathematics, yeah. Yes, and at the same time, he was studying music. You know,
yeah.
His name was Meyerer, Michel Meyerer. He was with I thought 25, 26 years old, and I did a lot of climbing with him.
Right.
He would never lead, however. He would never lead, but I felt happy with that.
You felt happy with that. In terms of, I mean, you're dealing with the sort of transplant surgeons and genius mathematicians, all these people. Your own schooling, I mean, how, did you leave school when you were quite young? Or, I mean, did you go to university?
Well, my school was rather poor. I liked to paint,
right.
You know? So my mother told me, which was very important to her, well, you have to learn something proper, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. So you go to school and of course, she would pay for that. I was learning make stained glass windows for mm-hmm. 4 years. But besides that, I always knew this, whenever I have a chance, I will become a guide, you know, now we have to turn the wheel a little bit back, I would become a guide and then make my living out of guiding.
As a guide, yeah.
And then when, you know, with 20, 21, I did never touch a glass anymore. You know? So I hate to say that because it's beautiful work. You know?
And yeah, yeah.
Whenever I'm in a big city, I go to the church and look at the stained glass windows.
Look at the stained glass windows, like really. You still have that
yes,
fascination.
Yes, this is still, yeah. Still there.
Yeah, wow. Reinhold, of course, climbed with Gunther a fair amount. How did you see their relationship?
Well, of course, in the early days, I spent quite a bit of time in Vilnius, where Reinhold was born,
right.
where he was also raised. And of course, I knew all his brothers. Mm-hmm. They had also a sister, Altraud. But with Günther, for some reason, I never got, of course, I knew him, mm-hmm. but I never climbed with Günther, which is strange,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because when I was there, of course, he climbed with me, we climbed together. Mm, and whenever I was in Austria or when I was guiding, he would be with Günther or with Eric or with other people.
Right.
He had a wide variety of friends he could go with, you know,
yeah,
so
yeah,
he didn't
yeah.
always need me, naturally.
No, of course. No. But that Nangaram Parbat expedition, when Günther died and Reinhold lost his toes.
You see, that's a sad story. There are more reasons for that. Normally, I would have been with Reinhold on that Nanga Parbat expedition, you know, led by Herlikofer.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was set, mm-hmm. everything was done, you know. But for some reason, we had to pay some money.
Right.
And at that stage, I was too stupid to get a sponsor, right? I was too dumb. And I had not these 2,000 German marks, which we had to pay.
Right.
Reinhold did pay them. So I chickened out.
Right.
I chickened out.
Because he didn't
have
the money.
In the last minute.
Wow. I didn't know this.
And then Günther came in.
Right.
You see?
Right.
So somehow, I shouldn't say I'm responsible for Günther's death. Of course, I could not say that. But I quite often was thinking, why the hell didn't you go? Günther would be alive because Günther went then.
But
on short notice.
My memory of it is that their father persuaded Herlikofer to take Günther as well.
That could be. I don't remember Reinhold's thoughts at that time, you know, because I had, as I said before, I had chickened out.
Right.
And then he had to look for another partner.
Right.
And then I think maybe his father told him, why don't you take Günther?
Because of course, afterwards, the father and son fell out. When Günther died, they had a big falling out over this, which, was very difficult.
That's right.
But, I mean, this had a big physical impact on, as well as the psychological scars from that time. It had a big physical impact on Reinhold in terms of his technical ability.
It was a difficult expedition,
ability.
You know. I mean, Reinhold Messner was very strong on Nanga Parbat. Of course, all the other guys also, I knew them all,
mm-hmm.
Scholz and Kuhn. Kuhn was a very difficult man, you know. Not all the Austrians are difficult, but some are difficult. Anyway, he was a very stubborn person, right?
Mm.
And I think the chemistry, we call it in German, the chemistry between the members was not perfect. I don't think so.
Yeah, yeah.
There was also Werner Heim, who is a very, very nice man. He was on that team. He had a fall. He was paralyzed later on. Still is, still alive. Almost all the other guys are dead on that expedition. And talking about when they reached the summit, I'm sure Messner, maybe he thought very quickly, let's go down on the other side, okay? The diamond side. But I can imagine that it was just a very quick thinking. Normally, Günther would be with him on the summit, okay? And they would come down. But Günther left later.
Yeah.
Reinhold went up already, and Günther sort of tried to catch up with him, which he finally did. Of course, then they team up, they stay together. And maybe because Günther was trying to go so fast, he would become tired.
More tired, more
right?
quickly.
More
yeah.
tired.
Yeah.
And then the whole things went bad when they went down. But it's not Reinhold's fault. I mean, what could he have done? Reinhold, they had reached safe terrain already, so to speak, safe terrain. You know, they had gone down, they had the bivouacs. Of course, they were both deadly tired, naturally. But when they reached the Daimir Glacier, it was flat. Of course, there are seracs, right? Little steep place, slopes anyway. And Reinhold had to, because Günther was so tired, Reinhold had to go forward to check the route to avoid that Günther would be with him and go back again to find another.
To find ways around crevasses.
So because
and stuff,
it's like a garden, like a labyrinth, as you say.
Yeah.
And then this was just tough luck that Günther, sort of being slower and being behind, was killed by probably an ice. I don't even know what it was, but it was an ice avalanche, probably.
Right, right. But the aftermath of that expedition has, down the years, has been quite poisonous in Austrian mountaineering generally, I think.
Yeah, well, it got an uprise again not long time ago because some of the guys who were on that team, you know, were unhappy and. Of course, I should say, Ed, I try always, and I did always try to stay out of these things.
Mm-hmm. You never felt that you had to intervene on Reinhold's behalf, or?
No, because I could not have done this.
Right.
Reinhold is too strong a person. If I want to tell him something, or if I would have told him, you know, calm down or whatever, it would not have helped.
Right.
So it's much better to stay out of it. And I have always, and all my life, tried, even if I have a fight with somebody, I don't want to fight all my life. I mean, we see, I don't want to name teams which have done a lot of climbing together. And then somebody said, out of this team, you know, two persons, someone said, well, no, you're an idiot. And the other guy will say, well, this is so bad. And he will be cross all his life. I never care. I'm much rather a person who, okay, well, we yell at each other for a moment, and then it's okay again. We stay still together. So I really, and I always managed mainly, to stay out of that.
Sure. Just going back to the physical impairment of Reinhold. I mean, he lost his toes. It changed his climbing.
Well, expeditions, and of course, climbing all the 14,000-8,000ers are changing your climbing anyhow.
Of course they are, but did you not feel that he went in that direction because, I mean, he was technically a good climber before.
Yeah, sure.
But when he lost his toes, it made it easier for him. Or do you think he would have done the 8,000ers anyway?
I think he would have done them anyway.
Really?
But of course, he didn't. Well, he lost. I mean, every loss on your feet is big enough. But, I mean, he didn't lose that much, right?
Okay.
So, of course, they took after Nanga Parbat when he was searching for Günther, and they had leather boots. He would stay the night out. It was freeze again, so he lost his toes. But, of course, it would affect his rock climbing, which it did. But then I think he was on a more adventurous trip, you know, doing all these 8,000ers, and Reinhold has shown us in a way that whenever a capital we call it, whenever a part of life is finished, he's doing something else. You
right,
know?
He's always thinking about the next thing.
Yeah. And when I came back from the expeditions, I started again climbing, I started guiding again, And then I was working again for another expedition, you know?
Right.
So my, I think I said it before, my world was much more the mountains than maybe his.
No, I understand. World, I understand the difference. I mean, of course, you then went on to do this tremendous route on Hidden Peak. And I mean, this was a new thing in a way, you know, this the way that you.
Yeah.
I mean, quite a new thing. Did you have it in, did you both have it in your minds at that stage that you were working towards?
Yes,
climbing
yes.
Everest in this
because,
way.
Because 75, you know, we went up that Baltoro, and then we I mean, the routes we did were not. I mean, if we compare with whatever is done today, I mean, they are easy, you know, much more easy. But in those days, the Hidden Peak climbing as a team of two, not using oxygen, naturally, did mean something.
Yeah.
Okay, and it gave us again a big, big, huge lift. So we knew, we had climbed Hidden Peak.
Mm-hmm.
And then 76, I didn't do anything. I stayed home. I had to make some money again because of, I had a family. I got married in 75 after we came back from Hidden Peak. In 77, we went to Dalagiri, but this was too big for us.
Mm.
The south face of Dalagiri, 4,000 meter high, steep, you know, avalanches and all that stuff. We were not successful, but in 77, already the thoughts were sort of cruising around Everest.
Yeah.
And of course, Reinhold was much more pushing it, you know, but he had a great follower. I would say, well, of course, let's give it a try.
Let's
do
go.
It, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I remember that time at an expedition where Norman Dyrenfurth was the leader. Of course, we don't talk about the American expedition in the 60s. There, he had an international expedition. And then there was this guy, Rebic, who was a very big, good climber like Herman Bull.
Yeah, yeah.
He would write, he told me later this, he would write a big letter to Dyrenforth telling him, I know two people who should be on your expedition because they can climb Everest not using oxygen.
Right.
But this was a long time before.
Really?
That, you know? Yes. I still have the letter
really?
In my house.
Yeah.
So anyway, Dyrenforth didn't take it,
yeah.
Okay, because his team was already set up and all that stuff. But going back to 77, we knew, and of course it took some preparation, and we knew in 78 we can go to Everest.
Right. The Dalagiri climb is a very interesting one because that face is, you know, in terms of the history of Himalayan climbing is very important. Can you just talk a little bit about what you experienced there? Because
it's a fantastic face. I mean, Dalagiri is a nice mountain anyway,
yeah.
You know, so not too high. I mean, 8,100 67.
Yeah.
So, but the approach was something already because we went up to that Tulokola, which is a valley where nobody had been there before, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we had to cut trees to make bridges and all that, and the porters ran away and because of raining and thunderstorm. So anyway, we reached base camp, and we had also a camera team with us from the CTF, which is the German television, and you know, the expedition was promoted very, very, very well.
Right.
But anyway, we didn't get high. Leo Dickinson was the filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
Eric Jones was with us, and we had a team of four climbers, who I went together with, or Messner went together with me, and there was an American guy, Mike Covington, having been together with the German guy, but the German guy didn't talk English, so it was a little. There was quite a bit of friction. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. And on the south face. On the south side of Dalagiri, you have a lot of snow always.
Mm-hmm.
In the morning, it's clear, it's crystal clear. Around 11 o'clock, it starts snowing. By 12 o'clock, by 1 o'clock, almost every day, the avalanches are coming on the south face, and we couldn't cope with that. And
and
being cheeky and being able to do things fast sometimes, we were always ready and willing to turn around, to go down. You know, we thought, well, this is too dangerous.
Mm.
And then I remember this one huge avalanche coming down once, and then everybody on the team said, well, that's it, let's forget it, you know, and then we turned back.
Right. This idea of, you know, being prepared to turn around if you didn't feel right is quite interesting in light of what happened on Everest, where Messner, it's fair to say, was pushing harder than you perhaps wanted to.
Yeah, but then again, you know, sometimes, of course, in a film, you know, you need one
drama.
Hero.
Yeah.
That's natural. And I can live with that, okay?
Yeah.
Because I knew I can go fast, I can do just as Reinhold does. I was, married, having been married 75, we had a boy together. He was very small, you know, 6 months or 7 months. So I knew from Everest, I want to come home.
Right.
Okay. And all the way up to so base camp, I thought, well, I want to see this house again coming out, because sometimes as you are on the approaches, you see something and you wonder, are you going to see this again?
Right.
Because we were not dumb in that respect. We knew that the chances that you could get something, you could get into trouble are always alive.
Right.
Okay. So anyway, and during that expedition, we made, well, I made, maybe also the other guys, we made many mistakes. I remember, for example, we had this very, very acid powder drink, you know, which we mixed much too
strongly.
Too strongly,
yeah.
For example, you know. Another thing, in base camp, every day we took, I took, also Messner probably, all the guys, sleeping pills.
Right.
Why the hell? We took Valium. Why would we take Valium, you know? Stupid. We didn't drink enough, you see? And of course, everything adds up. All these things, I want to say, add up. And during that expedition, of course, the film, The Unmasked Mountain, which is, I think, is a brilliant film made by Leo Dickinson, would show that there was a time when I thought, when I got sick, well, I have to give it a second thought, okay? Well, I'm more openly. If I have a problem, if I'm scared, I say it.
Right.
You know, maybe Reinhold was also scared. Maybe he was also a little bit afraid, but he would hide it.
Right.
But this is a personal question, you know.
Yeah.
The other one is.
It's funny you should say that that Reinhold comes across as the hero of the film, because I would have thought it was the other way around.
Yeah.
Because he was. You can see the determination. You know, he is so focused on this thing that nothing is. He is prepared to give up everything for it.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Well, yeah, there's a little, it's personal, and I may, it would not be bad if I say that, because we were talking last week on the Austrian television about this. You know, he was divorced then.
Yeah.
He had a divorce, which hurt him very, very much, you know. Mm. I remember him, he called me after that happened, and he was really out of, his mind was really hurt, and he himself, he was also hurt.
Mm.
So I, you know, there's a, we call it, I don't know the English word for it, we call it trotz, you know, let's do it. Mm. So he was pushing it, and lucky enough, we got together. I just see the outcome of it, you know. Mm-hmm. Psychologically, it's a very interesting thing which happened on that expedition. And, but lucky enough, we teamed up again and could do it finally, you know.
Mm.
Of course, we had fantastic people around us.
Sure.
You know?
I mean, strong guys.
We had strong guys around us. So it was not a thing, Messner and Habeler only. You know, we were cushioned in a very nice family, so to speak. You know, there was the expedition leader, Nyatz, who left us whatever we wanted to do. We were free to move or not to move and to do things or not to do things. On top of that, we had two doctors. You know, they later on became worldwide big men, and especially one, Dr. Margreiter, who became he was strong in transplant surgery. I remember talking to him a lot, and he said, "Peter, you can do it. You can easily do it." You know, and also Reinhold said this, and then of course, okay,
you were happy.
So we had the support. Yeah. From the team, we had also, we should not forget, we had also the support of the Sherpas, right? And I was always very fond of the Sherpas. I think the Sherpa belongs to an expedition. The Sherpas, however, in our golden age of climbing these 8,000ers, were not playing the role they would play now. The Sherpas would help us carrying things.
Right.
But there was never a moment when a Sherpa was ahead of us.
Right.
Never.
Right.
But I like the Sherpas. Because of their friendliness, of their happiness, of their helpfulness, and I still do. You know, the Sherpa to me is.
And you go back to Nepal quite frequently, don't you?
Well, 65 times I've been out there.
Right. So you know them very well.
Yeah.
after Everest, was that the kind of break in your relationship with Messner, or did that come later?
It was a break. I mean, there was a stupid thing, not a stupid thing, but I was the first one, because Reinhold went, after this expedition, he went on to climb Nanga Parbat,
right,
to solo it,
yeah,
right? And I was, of course, I was pushed to write a book, and I like to write.
Yeah.
I do like to write. I also, already in school, I much more than mathematics, for example, okay?
Right.
So I did. And this, Reinhold hurt, he was hurt when he came back, you know. Then, of course, I had the feeling, now I must stay also with my family. And Reinhold was very strong. Mm-hmm. He had climbed Everest, he had climbed Nanga Parbat, he had soloed Nanga Parbat. And at that stage, and maybe earlier, he knew, well, I can do all the, himself, I can do all these 8,000ers. But I had to be very careful not to goof up my family.
Yeah.
So I stayed with my family, and I promised my wife then, I will not be on the expeditions anymore, which I broke again after. But it was a while, from 78 until 84.
Before you went back.
Right.
Right.
You know, but it was important. It was very important.
And at that time to stay.
It was
home.
Very yeah. important. Yeah. And I was very happy. You know, yeah. I was able to build a house. I was doing all these things which one in life would want to accomplish, you know, to have a son. We had a beautiful son. I had a house. We had some trees. Mm. It was, everything was fine, you know. Some lectures, we could make some money. And only later on, I felt the urge again, okay, let's go and do another 8,000.
And that was
K2.
That was, right.
Yeah, Jogori.
Yeah, and you didn't get up that?
No, we didn't get up. It was weather-wise not possible.
Sure, but then you went back for Kanchenjunga.
Kanchenjunga was my last 8,000. I climbed in the meantime after... having not been successful on K2, I climbed Nanga Parbat.
Right.
And with great people, you know, with this German Michael Dacher,
yes,
again as a
yeah.
team of two.
Yeah.
I had the chance to meet Marcel Rüdi, which was another
yes.
great man, could climb Chōyu from the Polish ridge, which is much nicer than the north, you know, the north side
the usual approach. Yeah.
And after, and my best and my nicest memories are sort of going back to Kanchenjunga.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
The base camping Pambema, this huge, huge, great north face and good people.
Right.
I who mean, you I was climb,
who
lucky.
You, I mean, you were talked about it last night about what a pleasure that expedition was. Who
yeah.
were you climbing with?
I was climbing, of course, last night I couldn't tell all these stories because
the slides are moving so quickly.
Were running yeah. through, okay? Yeah. And I couldn't stop it. Anyway, Carlos Bula, you know, and
yes.
Martin Sabaleta,
right.
And those guys, everything was just great. Not one loud word, and Kanchenjunga was a mountain where we were very, very close to dying.
Right.
Very close.
Why?
This was because of the weather again.
Right.
You know, it took us a long time. Kanchenjunga is, as you all know, is big.
Yeah.
Is big. Is
yeah.
sort of a frontier mountain.
Yeah.
You know, it's the last one in that row, the Himalayan, and there are terrible storms.
Yeah.
It is very cold. You can have a lot of new snow. You can have a meter of snow or even more during a night.
Mm.
And then, of course, what to do? You sit up there and how you... And it's avalanche prone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's serac prone.
Mm.
So anyway, we climbed this peak. And personally, I felt strong on Kanchenjunga. Everything was done fine. The acclimatization was right. We had a good doctor in base camp. We had good food. We had a very good, warm relationship between each other, which is very, very important. Because
was that different from your earlier expeditions? Did you feel that you kind of matured in the way that you went
well,
about
of
things?
Of course, I knew more.
Yeah.
I mean, 1980, I knew much more about climbing on Everest. I was,
yeah.
I think, I was a schoolboy.
Yeah.
If I look back yeah. on Everest, because of doing so many things wrong.
Yeah.
You know?
You were naive.
I was naive.
Yeah.
I was very naive on Everest. Okay,
yeah.
So we were lucky. I was lucky to be able to get up, to go up. But on Kanch, everything fell into place, and of course it's such a strong mountain because coming back from the summit, you know, we had an agreement from that last camp. Okay, Peter, you go. You are faster, so why don't you go ahead? And the weather turned bad, you know. So. And we wanted to be the expedition successful. So they let me go. My friends let me go. I started. I was on the top of Kanchenjunga around 10 o'clock.
Right.
10 o'clock in the morning. And then doing the pictures, you know, getting this aluminum pole up and doing the pictures. And I remember also on top of Kanchenjunga, there's a little tiny Korean plastic man, you know, which I hardly saw because then the weather was moving in already. And then I made it down to the last camp. Carlos Bühler and Martin Sabaleta actually was the next one coming. As I go down, he comes up and tired. Carlos way behind, but they made also the summit. And then I was waiting, and I was back in this high tent by 12 o'clock. Right. I remember that. Why? Because at 12 o'clock, I took the walkie-talkie, which was left in the tent, and told our doctor down in base camp, I come from the summit, and the boys will come soon. You know, the guys will, my friends will come soon. And then it was about until 9 o'clock in the evening, from 12 o'clock till 9 o'clock until the guys came, because the weather was terrible. It was snowing very hard. It was windy. So there was a whiteout. They could not see anything as they came down. And only when it opened up a little bit, which was later on, there was about maybe 60 centimeters of new snow.
Wow.
They had to plow through. And when it opened up, they saw this big terrace, which leads you again to the point where you can go down. And then they came. I mean, we were almost dead. I had a cough. Martin had a big cough, and Carlos had been frostbitten. And the next day, I remember this very well, Carlos and Martin did not want to start. They did not want to go down,
right?
You know? So that was the only time when I started yelling.
Right.
Because I knew if we have another night here, there was snow in the tent.
And what altitude is that camp?
Well, that's at the beginning of that last right. Pyramid. Is it, Kanchenjunga is 8,500. So, 68 or something like this.
Yeah.
79 something. Yeah. It's a long, long way up.
You're still very, very high.
You're still very high. Well, I knew we are not surviving. We are going to be dead. So I started to get the guys out of the tent. Okay. Yeah. And no. You know, let's spend another night. And I said, no. If you don't go, I go.
Right.
I start. And I did start. But I thought, well, so I went back and, come on, let's go, come on. And then I waited until they got out of tent. Because if I would have gone further down, they would have stayed.
Sleep, yeah.
And
yeah.
Then there was a very, very difficult, it's not difficult, but it's a very long, flat, it's a kind of a terrace, but you cannot go down on the left side, sort of north side, because you have all these seracs. So I went to this point of, I would say, of no return, where we had to find this big pole which we had planted, where there was a fixed rope going down into easier terrain. And I didn't find that. And Carlos Bühler and Martin Sabaleta stayed about 20 meters above me and were sort of very slowly going, you know. I had to plow as well. And they would yell on, Peter, you're much too low, you're too low. And I said, no, I'm right. I'm fine, you know, there's no problem. So I went across, and then I couldn't find this edge.
Yeah.
I could not find it. It took me about 3 hours.
Oh, wow.
So I went very close to that steep thing, starting the avalanches.
Yeah.
And my friends were, in the meantime, they were sitting. They didn't move. Of course, that was okay.
Yeah.
That was nice, because they were tired. I was also tired, but I knew if we are not going to make it, we are dead.
Yeah.
So then closer and closer and closer, and all of a sudden I saw the start of the rope.
Yeah.
And then
you knew that you were okay.
Then we were safe.
Yeah.
Then we went down, and then of course we had two more bivouacs, because all the camp three was gone, camp two was gone. We had a lot of equipment there, you know. I remember I was sorry about my Leica camera which was gone. So we just dig some holes and we stay there. And then after the second bivouac, we come down to camp one. And the Sherpas came to help us, you know, with the tea. And it ended
perfectly.
Nice. It ended perfectly.
Peter,
that was a big thing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.